Mumbai police or whatever police, to all the state police, took a lot of grants. Mr. Chidambaram had introduced new concepts in policing, desert policing for the expected lines through that desert, coastal policing, hill area policing, everything. Specific designs were made. Now coastal boats, assistance was given by coastal boats. Most of the coastal areas, strict coastal states excepting these, then combined Andhra Pradesh and Gujarat, all of them did not even have trained personnel. The coastal boats have been abandoned. They are gathering dust, they have become rusted junk. That is the reason why on 31st December 2014, our Indian Coast Guard, with the help of Gujarat Maritime Authority, could preempt a particular attack, similar attack like the Mumbai one. Because of that, one of the strengths was.
Hello and welcome to P-Guru's channel. I'm your host, Sri Iyer. Today, I have the pleasure of Sri RVS Mani's company, and we're going to talk about something very interesting. Mr. Mani, welcome to P-Guru's channel.
Namaskar.
So, Mr. Mani, I had watched this movie called Hotel Mumbai that is about the 26/11 incident. And since you had a ringside view of what was happening from the control tower in Delhi, I thought we will just take a few minutes to talk about this, to discuss some of the interesting things that are portrayed in the film, and perhaps you can give your context, you can add more context to these things. So first thing I want to start with about this movie is, from the name you can tell it is concentrating on the happenings in the Taj Hotel, which is why it says, you know, Hotel Mumbai. And what happened in that hotel is the main story. There are other things that are added to that. The first question I had for you, sir, is the way it shows it, it just shows them landing somewhere along the beach of Mumbai. Where did you think exactly they landed?
Colaba Shores.
Okay. How many people?
Colaba Seashore, they landed. Yeah.
How many people?
Hello.
How many people?
10 of them were there.
Okay. Yeah, please continue. Please continue.
And they walked through that fisherman's colony, called the Colaba Koliwada or whatever it is, through to the Badwar Park, the nearest place where they could take a vehicle, or some vehicle were waiting for them. We have discussed it, whether it was a welcome party waiting for them or they had taken a taxi, whatever it is. I believe that somebody must have accompanied them through, because navigating into that colony also is no easy task. You require a person quite well versed with that, about the topography of the Koliwada, and then land in Badwar to reach to that point in Badwar Park. That's it.
So
whichever side they landed from.
So the way they show it in the movie is 10 people land there. And they just show a lot of boats around them, activity. It's as if everybody is ignoring what is going on. All these people are in their teens, probably 15 to 25 or something like that. And they all speak some sort of Punjabi mostly. And they seem to be fairly, you know, from a very rural background. They haven't seen some of the modern amenities, if you will. And they seem to be carrying automatic weapons with them in their bags, and they also have backpacks. Now, the question that comes to my mind is, the way they show it, it's as easy as 1, 2, 3, they get into a cab and they say, go to this place, go to this place, go to this place. If you reach there quickly, I'll give you a tip, something like that. Was it so easy to catch a cab at Colaba in the evening rush hour time?
Is one of the basic questions which needs to be asked and repeatedly asked. Colaba, see, nowadays things of app-based taxis and all have come. 2008, either it was a Meru or some other Meru or some Easy Taxi or Easy Cab or somebody. Otherwise, it was a Kalipili taxi of the Mumbai, which was cab. And in the evenings in Mukulaba, it will be next to impossible to get a taxi instantly. What to talk of three taxis? And number two is, you said people ignored. Boats, they landed in between all the cluster of boats very well. People cleaning their fishing nets and all is very common sight in that area in the evening. Walking through the colony, whatever colony, because in that area only fishermen's colonies are there. It's a sort of a traditional stronghold of them. Walking through that area, first thing is fishermen's colony, generally in the evening there's a lot of activity, socializing and all. Walking through the area, when you had said that the film says nobody looked at them, ignored them, everybody ignored them. My question is, that is a myth. If you walk through, they are very possessive and a lovely community, but if you enter, any stranger enters, somebody would have certainly asked the question.
So my counter to that is, so after the fact, when police went and did investigations, what transpired?
See, basically, I also said, and an indication also comes from Home Minister's reply in a parliament question. Start question, oral replies are there. That Kasab had confessed to an Indian hand, some Indian hands in the, it's a Lok Sabha oral answer by the Minister of State, whom Home Minister has approved the reply. That's the essence of it. Or that's on account of that only one Joint Secretary was shifted out of Home Minister because of that question, the reply. That was a compromise. Kasab confessed to Indian hands involved, help, having received help from Indians. But Mumbai police did not pursue that.
Well,
so this is a statement. Home Minister said, Home Minister's version is there. So the question is, was somebody remote controlling the investigation? This is a very, very subtle give out of the entire thing. Was somebody remote controlling the investigation from Delhi? And even this question of, now we have said that the film has been captured. Maybe the film has been captured for a Western audience who don't know the Indian social ethos of how the fishermen people interact. They would not allow any stranger. If 10 strangers in a group are coming into their colony, I don't think they would have got a free way to walk through the colony so easily. They are very possessive of it. And here these 10 were carrying all the weapons and communication equipment and whatnot. So nobody saw that or everybody ignored it. It doesn't add up. You have lived in India. You know how even in a normal colony, in a middle class colony, somewhere in Chennai or Delhi or in even my own society, if you are a stranger walking into it, around 10 fellows will say, two people will guide you where to go. These are not very normal, at least 15 years back or 10 years back when this happened. In a colony like Fisherman's Colony, it is 100% happened. To say that everybody ignored this is not the right capture. And especially they were carrying a huge cache of arms along with them on their body. And number three is, as per that, they had left the dinghy some short of the area and probably swam through the water or walked through the water or whatever it is.
But didn't India recover the dinghy to find out where the dinghy was and so on and so forth?
I don't think that happened. It was only in the report.
That is shocking. I mean, you can't even finish collecting the evidence. What exactly was Mumbai police doing?
The complicity, I don't know whether it was Mumbai police or it was remote control from Delhi or Mumbai headquarters or whatever it is, from somewhere somebody was directing the investigation.
Well,
I will suggest you one thing. Rakesh Maria was the supervising officer of the Mumbai 2611 because the ATS had collapsed. New people had come, and since ATS has lost a lot of manpower, it was given to the Mumbai crime branch, which is Rakesh Maria. Now he has written a book on that, to what extent he has captured the real facts, etc. I want to comment on that. But when Chidambaram's bail case came up, when his bail was rejected by the High Court, on a TV channel I have said something that Rakesh Maria, Chidambaram and all had been very pally about this. I come it on record and I know that. So perhaps in that context only it was I respective as an officer, but in that context some interventions have been happening. The agitation which Mr. Chidambaram showed when the true facts were put on the reply to the question by the Joint Secretary, which was not acceptable to Chidambaram, he tweaked the reply. This part of the Mumbai police did not go further into that, was a tweaked part, and also all evidences were, you know, it also say intercepts were shared with Pakistan. He knocked out the word all, because all intercepts were not shared. He wanted all intercepts. Somebody did not like that. He did not want to tell a lie in the parliament. The officer drafting the reply. So he was transferred. A compromise was struck. And the tweaked part is intercepts. So these two are the two vital points on which our friend Chidambaram transferred the officer. It is a matter of record. I have come out on that. Even the intercepts are varied also in the reply to the same question. Please.
Sir, we have a few more questions to go, so I just wanted to, I've compelled to stop you there, sir. Sorry about that.
But
viewers who have read this book of Rakesh Maria can perhaps throw some light on whether he confirmed that the dinghy itself was captured. Because having 10 people, and this probably came at least 15, 20 miles away from the shore, and that means it was a motorized dinghy. That's what is shown in the movie. For the most part, the movie is fairly accurate. They're not hiding anything. They're not making it look like this is being kid gloved or anything. It's pretty raw. And I'm going to go through the questions. You'll see it's a pretty raw description of what happened. And so that is one thing that I think we would like to park it there. Let's go to the next question, because you'll see that these questions are fairly interesting. The next question is, Ajmal and one other guy are sent to the CST, to the railway station, right? Ajmal Kasab and one other guy, right? They are caught, they went to the CST station. So they come out of the toilet and they start blazing away. Right. And then the movie depicts them going out, running on the street and waiting somewhere where a police van starts coming with the lights on. And these guys gun down the driver and the police traveler also. And they get into this van and then they go on. Now, my question, sir, in all this is, where was Ajmal Kasab caught? And is this part true?
The exact location is, I will have to go through. Because the charge sheet, wherever it was, because it has been established, charge sheet, he was caught, and he was caught by the same police party. And he was overcooked because it was a sort of a melee. Then the DCP crime, somebody else also started walking into that. I'm not getting his name very prominent. So all of them, and in that melee, the Tukaram Omde confronted him. He caught him by his hand. Sheer muscle power. And took all the bullets on his. And he ensured that this fellow doesn't die. That is the most important part. Otherwise, we would have still had that about our friend Rakesh Maria has captured in his book, The Time to Tell It or whatever it is, that it would have been turned a Hindu attack. But thanks to Tukaram Mumbale that we have been able to say that it is a Pakistan.
So somebody,
exact small, location.
Yeah, a small police constable, poor guy, laid down his life to make sure that the truth actually came out. I think the nation owes a huge debt of honor to this person. And what struck me was, so according to your recollection, this guy was caught in the train station itself, right? Ajmal Kasab?
No, outside the train. See, the irony is, right opposite to the train station, turning towards the Baba Hospital, the Mumbai Commissioner's office or something like that.
I see.
If Mumbaiites will confirm it, they were running through that. At that time only he was caught. something like some school of art is also there. I from the written record, I say somewhere around that commissioner office school of art, then somewhere they say the hospital comes. That is the topographic. People from Mumbai will be able to confirm it, who have lived there or who have worked in that area, will be able to confirm it. But the reports which you are receiving, which is sounds in my ear, some school of art, some commissioner office, that is the way, somewhere around that area only tomorrow only caught. If I recollect it correctly, on because it's around 12 years now, so I'm also speaking out because it was in a continuous flow of information.
So here is the other interesting thing. There are two other sites that they mentioned. One is that just a brief showing in CST. Then they show the shooting in Lelopal or Cafe Lelopal, and then they show some people who escape the Lelopal gunning, and then they run towards Taj and they take refuge in Taj, and there they get gunned down. Poor guys. It's a real sad situation. I mean, you escape once and then you go and get caught in Taj, and then there they get gunned. These are foreign kids, and it's really sad, because why I say sad is there is so much of confusion, and the police that finally eventually that tries to get in, if I look at the arms that they are having, there are two people with revolvers, each one is using one of those 0.38 Wesson types, where there is a shell chamber of 6 bullets. That's all they can fire, 6 bullets. And then the other constables are having this 0.303 rifles that were issued in World War II. Sir, this is the special task force that the Mumbai police deputes until the special forces from Delhi have to arrive. So essentially, whoever was there, they were completely at the mercy of these terrorists. And what is the response team? Is that what the Mumbai police had at that time? And more importantly, today, God forbid, if something like this were to happen today, how well equipped is the Mumbai police?
I will tell you basically 2-3 things. Mumbai police or whatever police, all the state police, took a lot of grants. Mr. Chidambaram had introduced new concepts in policing. Desert policing for the expected lines through that desert, coastal policing, hill area policing, everything required. Specific designs were made. Now, coastal boats, assistance was given to 5 coastal boats. Most of the coastal areas, strict coastal states, excepting these, then combined Andhra Pradesh and Gujarat, all of them did not even have trained personnel. And the coastal posting stations, coastal boats have been abandoned. They are gathering dust, they have become rusted junk. That is the reason why on 31st December 2014, our Indian Coast Guard, with the help of Gujarat Maritime Authority, could preempt a particular attack, similar attack like the Mumbai one. Because of that, one of the strengths was there. Number two, whatever the things happened afterward, emergency response vehicles were given, centrally funded. Quick response teams were funded for raising quick response teams. I don't know what is the status of the quick response team or emergency. I see some vehicles marked as ERVs carrying rations for the policemen, senior officers' families. Other than that, ERVs, for example, in many cases, even after that, QRTs could have been deployed. I don't know in any of them it was deployed. In Tabligh Jamaat case, the recent one, QRT could have been deployed. In something like a Durga Mandir attack in the old Delhi last year, QRTs could have been deployed. The situation went out of control in Teesajari, QRT could have been deployed. But because the QRTs are not air, it is all running personal errands. The personnel have also not lost. I have lost all the skills that I have got during this training and all that is almost 7 to 8 years or 10 years back. So after that, for photo ops, a lot of operation, upgradation was taken place. But how much they have been harnessed, used, and continuously upgraded is a matter of question. This also, the police establishment in each of the states should answer. Because coastal police stations are a very vital thing. which we have lost sight of. And that's end of it. After 2012, I don't think much of the upgradation has taken, except in two or three exclusive states, as you mentioned.
Well, see, if you look at
what they divided the Andhra Pradesh also.
If you had looked at
they divided Andhra Pradesh state also. No, please.
Yeah. If you look at what had happened in Delhi riots in February 24th and 25th, the police were still dealing with the whole thing with using lathis, and the other guys were firing at them. Firing. There's acid bombs being thrown. There's firing being done. It tells me that whatever be the quick response teams and all these things, even Delhi itself doesn't seem to have. So what exactly was the government thinking not to deploy the special forces to quell the riots on 24th and 25th February? I'm just curious, sir. Law and order is law and order. When there is something called as mob fury, no reason goes out the window. Nobody is even thinking whether what they are doing is right or wrong. When mob fury sets in, the only way to solve it is to act, and act swiftly, and act in a very, very decisive way. That's the only way mobs will stop, you know, reacting. So why did this government not employ the special forces on 24th and 25th February? What were they thinking?
I'll tell you, I'll take you back to even 9th February 2016. JNU, not just anti-national, tukde, slogans were shouted. Even at that time, the situation of out of control, there was no QRT deployed. Later on, the last, before the Shaheen Bagh and all, before the CAA, there were most of the roads of the Delhi were blocked by the JNU for a stupid reason, for hostile charges raised. They had blocked the Delhi, almost half of Delhi was closed. At that time, they had no QRTs to be responsible. So it was not just that one fine morning they found that the QRTs are under equipped. The challenges have been there, opportunities were there where they could have deployed ERVs and QRTs, but nobody really assessed it. So when it really came to the crunch, the Delhi police was found lacking. I don't know, because these things happened in 2009, 10, etc. I don't know if the present police establishment or even having the institutional records, or they think it is just a vehicle like any other deployed vehicle. But we had already given them a lot. Then 24/7 helplines, everything was created, including the CCTNS. But everything has been now, all the assets created at the time have been not harvested.
Okay, so I think the Delhi State Police, at least Delhi Police, not Delhi State, Delhi Police owes an explanation on their preparedness. This is not something that is, this is very clear, very clear cut law and order. You have to serve and protect. If that basic function is not being done, and it is being done based on political considerations, I mean, plot is lost a long time ago. I think that's what the country needs to know. That is my personal input, sir, because I looked at that movie and then I cast my mind forward and said, how India is prepared today to deal with it. Maybe it has a little bit better intelligence, but that doesn't, you know, translate itself into success unless you have swift ability to act and cut these things off. Tablighi Jamaat, how the heck were so many people allowed to come inside when there was a complete lockdown in place? So this is repeating itself, and it's only going to get worse. And this is a shout out to say, get your systems functioning, get your systems in place. And last question, sir, about this movie. We're running a little late, so I don't want to keep talking about this. They show a bunch of people escaping from using this one Sardarji called Arjun Singh. He brings them all out along with the main chef too. How is that how it played out? Because I don't remember reading the news about who escaped.
Sardarji manager, some Kang or somebody. Someone Sardarji manager was there.
Yes.
He had played a vital role. He had played a vital role in helping Taj people. But 160, more than 166 people died. I don't know what was the occupation and all. Because what happens is we only get the report. Home is the ultimate casualty reporter. How many security people can, even if you see the Home Ministry's answers everywhere, security forces killed, civilians killed, like that only it comes.
I see.
People escape. Is never in the centrally maintained. Okay.
Now,
that is one, that is for the state government. So that is one big flaw in the reporting mechanism. Number two is, even in this also, for example, which happens in Jammu and Kashmir area, Jammu and Kashmir people killed, civilians killed are totally consolidated and given. How many fell to terrorist bullets and how many to security forces, that is never distinguished. It's a design to give leverage to human rights people. That I also felt. Number two, another important thing about the intelligence fact, marine intelligence, because Gujarat had set up the maritime authority, there is a big starting point for the intelligence areas also. You go to the Ganga Sagar area and try to get the intelligence of what is happening in Bay of Bengal, the marine, where we had already discussed about the China's deployment of certain unarmed vehicles and missiles and all that. There, the marine intelligence still needs to be reinforced. Paradeep area, west eastern coast, also a lot of intelligence needs to be reinforced. Recently, I read a report about around 15 Tablighis going to and settling in Lakshadweep. I don't know, some paper article I read. These type of things happening on the peninsula of India is also a matter of concern, where the intelligence capacity has to be highly increased. Plus, the desert intelligence also needs, because I have spoken about a 360-degree chance of an attack. Desert could be the next. They have tried the hilly area, they have tried the plain, now they have tried the coastal. Jaisalmer area is a sitting duck. Lot of things are happening. Barmer, Jaisalmer, Ganganagar, or Tisaral area, there is a lot of potential, lot of mobilization from the other side of the border happening. So this is a very, very vulnerable point. Shout out, I say, with full confidence and authenticity. With full responsibility, I say.
Well, let's hope that the people who are supposed to take care of this act on the intelligence inputs that you have provided, sir. Thank you very much. This has been a very revealing conversation. We don't know if you're going to have another movie with more details, but I felt the movie was fairly okay. And they talk about the handlers. Now, some of these, handsets were there. They could have easily figured out from the voice of the handler who the person was. So the handlers have been identified, right? Two handlers, right? One is called Bull.
Major Javed.
No, two handlers are talked about in the movie. One is referred as Bull.
They were giving instruction from Karachi.
Yeah.
They are the swimming and marine trainers of these all 10 fellows.
Now,
Mudrike, thereafter these fellows came to say, spend 15 to 20 days in Karachi. From Mudrike, they came here. There they could do all the marine and sea training. Because they were very, very poor people coming from poor families for sheer bread and butter, they came and joined this with the assurance that if they get killed, the family will be financially well rehabilitated. That is the basic reason why Karsav and others got at it.
Actually, no. There is, according to the movie, one of the guys who is standing guard on some Americans, he's asking the question to his handler, have you given the money? And then he says, yeah, I have given the money. And this boy calls up his parents and he asks his dad, did you get the money? And the dad says, no, I haven't got the money. So there is some divergence here. So it's not, I think, at dying. I think they are supposed to have been given the money just for participating in the whole thing.
Possible.
Yeah. But the point I'm trying to make is, I don't think they got compensated, even for the, assuming that these were like an act of mercenary and they did this, I don't think they got compensated.
Only ISI can answer, or Pakistan establishment can answer. So whether they got the money or not.
Yeah.
So, Kassab being in much more limelight would have been compensated. But others, it's a matter of, again, conjecture.
You see, the thing is, if you listen to the kind of thought process these kids are going through, there is so much venom filled in their minds about Hindus and Hinduism and India, that to me, it almost seems like a pointless exercise to try and win the minds and hearts of Pakistanis. That's not going to happen. Only total surrender is going to happen, wherein somebody wakes up today morning or one day morning and realizes everything that the person has learned up until that time in his or her life is a lie. That today is a new beginning and there's a new truth. Something like that only will take this beyond that, because I don't see the way this thing is portrayed, that these people are even looking at what is the truth. And I'm afraid the same kind of untruths are also coming into India now. I mean, otherwise I can't explain why a Tablighi Jamaati, having been caught being coronavirus positive, tries to spit at the policeman.
I will put it this way. See, Pakistani, as a matter of, have been sponsoring this type of things through, they call it a psyops, psychological operation.
Right.
Psy war, psychological warfare. Many of the programs in Pakistani TV channels, GOTV or whatever it is, or you will find these type of programs very ad throughout the day. Especially their penetration is right into the rural Pakistan, where the rancor against Hinduism, Hindus, India, they say that Indians, in India, the Hindu fellows, they will cut a Muslim and eat, all sorts of things are there. Your dramas are portrayed. It's a fact that it is an ISI funded program, its content is made by somebody and given by a Benami thing into the TV. It's very common. It's not a cyber. It also has been aired in the channels which could be seen in the border areas of Punjab, which could be seen in Srinagar, Jammu, Patan, Baramula and all, they will clearly air it. So that part of the public, the thing is always under the threshold. They have intentionally done it. Apart from that, and the entire Pakistani lower middle class and the poor people have got a total rancor, hatred against India. Only those upmarket Pakistanis who are captivated by the Bollywood thing. Only they want to come to, even the delegate will say, sir, meeting Mumbai Miracle. So that is the only thing. Otherwise, all this lower middle class absolutely hatred. They have absolute hatred for India. They are Hindus or Indians and all that. About it, Tablighi also, now it is happening in, it is not happening now, it has been happening right. Tablighi has been doing it. See, Tablighi is nothing but an extension of Jamaat-e-Islami. I have told it in my book also. I have told it, I have been telling it for the last 15 years. That it is Arkatul Jamaat-e-Islami outfit. And they have been doing also the anti-India, anti-Hindu nonsense right from across the border in Indo-Bangladesh border. In 2006-07, it is a matter of official record. Anybody can go and verify it. And the monitoring group, which we were, we used to do it, everyone, one gentleman came and he abandoned that. He disbanded that group. So these are all matters of record in Home Ministry. Then after 2009-10, we were doing it till the Joint Secretary was shifted out from the, because of the Parliament question, and the subsequent officers did not find it fit to conduct these monitorings. This is a clear matter of record that 2nd March he was transferred and thereafter the monitoring stopped. It is not only here, it stopped. So it affected so many other dimensions of internal security. Counterterrorism. Well,
what I'm really amazed is this individual who did all these things, then still is routinely violating court orders not to talk to, not to make press statements, not to, you know, indulge in verbal inexactitudes, and life still goes on, and no court is taking so much cognizance of all these things.
I respect the court, so I reserve myself. But court should be more consistent in their rulings. In a case of Supreme Court, it was approached without any basis, without the locus standi of the person. The Supreme Court gave house arrest, not custodial interrogation. But today, Arnab Goswami was interrogated for 12 hours. Although they had given a protection, same judge, in a conspiracy to assassinate the Prime Minister, sitting Prime Minister of India, they say no, he can be interrogated from their own residence, Kasi residence. But in this case, they say Arnab Goswami to cooperate with them. Go to the police station and get his statement. And the police takes it as it use it as a ruse for almost 12-hour interrogation. And about this judge, I will not, no comment. He may be a very meritorious man. Normally, it takes 15 to 20 years for any advocate to get a senior designation in any of them. 10 years is the minimum period. 10 years of continuous, uninterrupted practice in judicial, in high court. As soon as he completes his 10-year or within 1 or 2 years, he's elevated to the, he's given a designation of senior in Mumbai High Court. And that is given only to ensure that as another 2 years of, again, he's elevated as a judge of the Mumbai High Court. From there, his career starts.
Yes.
So this is the way judges have been brought, cultivated right from the embryonic stage.
Well, and we
can give favorable judgment whenever you want. You can go. There's a lot of IOU into that. That's what is my. I respect all the judges equally and very high esteem, but that is the IOU. These are all matters of record. Anybody see on 82, this gentleman passes out law, then goes to Harvard, then goes to some other place, as a PhD by the time. And 2 years it takes for a successful practice, 2 years it takes actual practice. It takes to learn the High Court rules and filing procedure is also elaborate. And with the 10 months or 8 months working of the judiciary, it takes almost 16 months to learn it. And he has given conferred, effectively he has been conferred senior designation in 8 to 10 months, 8 to 8 years. These are all larger ecosystem issues.
Absolutely.
So
So absolutely right. See, what I see is if you, the rot started in 1947. Right from that time, even, you know, the everything, all the institutions, judicial institutions, you know, banking institutions, everything has been slowly but steadily. These have been brought down brick by brick. If you look at, like, for example, 1969, when the Supreme Court struck down the nationalization of banks, the parliament turned around and passed a law essentially saying that whatever the Supreme Court says is not valid. And see, that, those are all major, major things that you are not supposed to have done. That point forward, the banking system has completely, you know, fallen away, if you will, because it became a slave of the government. The government could do whatever they want. And likewise, in what you're saying in judiciary, superstition of judges for Supreme Court judges, Justice A.N. Ray, I think. Mrs. Gandhi did that. Yeah. One individual. One individual. Remember this, India. One individual can wreak havoc. And that's what you're seeing again and again. One individual can wreak havoc. It takes a village to put it back together. So that is the kind of monumental rebuilding exercise that is going on at the center now. And that patience is needed to get this thing right. And there are some places where things go wrong. I think we have to be all patient. I don't want to be sounding too discordant, but I think we are still discovering how many things have gone wrong. And that's where the challenge is. And Mr. Mani, thank you so much. I'm sorry if I kind of put you on the spot on some of the questions here, but I just felt that 12 years later, I don't think India is in a better position to ward off some of these kind of situations that it went through in 2008. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, certainly.
Hi, everyone. In the current scenario with the spread of COVID-19, the printed books are on the verge of becoming outdated. And ebooks are becoming the mainstream way of reading. You can now read our ebook, Who Painted My Money White, comfortably on the Kindle app on your phone or a tab. So now, I'm going to show you how to download Kindle on your phone. Firstly, open Play Store or App Store depending upon your phone. we are following Play Store process, though the process is similar for both Android and iOS. In the search bar, type Amazon Kindle. Tap the first result to open the application page and press Install. Once installed, press Open to start the application. Use your credentials to log in. If you were already logged into an Amazon account, then you will directly reach the welcome page for the app. Tap on Start Reading and then tap on Get Started. Now in the search bar, type the book name or the author name and it will show you the relevant results. Tap on the book and then tap on Read for Free. iPhone users can buy the book at a discounted price of just ₹199. You get a 30 days trial for the app on Android. Tap on the button. On the next screen, press Continue to reach the payment page. After entering your payment details, click on Place your order. Once the process is complete, it will show a message saying, "We are setting up your membership." Pressing the cross on the top right corner of the screen will take you back to the book results page. Tap on the book and then tap on Read for Free. It will open a new page. Here you can follow the author and then tap on Read Now. It will now open the ebook and you can happily enjoy reading it.